In the previous video, we downloaded the dataset and set it up. And now in this video, we are going to implement the dataset class and the data loaders. So in this video, we are going to do it a little bit differently and use Visual Studio Code, a code editor, instead of JupyterLab. It's useful to know about a code editor because sometimes we can't run JupyterLab, and JupyterLab really is, I mean, its strength is really teaching and tinkering or data analysis. However, if you run code in production environments, you likely are dealing with Python libraries, developing Python libraries, or running code, let's say, from the terminal. And for that, it's useful to also know how to use a code editor. So here I have my terminal, and how I personally like to open Visual Studio Code in that folder is by executing code dot, which will open Visual Studio Code exactly in this folder. So I have different files here. I have here a file that I want to define, my data loader, where I want to define and run it to test it out, the data loader that we just defined in the previous video. And I already have this mnist.png folder here, which we downloaded and prepared in the last video. So let's actually get to the coding part now. So usually at the top, I like to put my imports. It's usually a best practice in Python code to have all the imports at the top. And then we are going to implement the dataset class. So here the dataset class is defining how we load data from our computer. So we have this init method here, like we discussed in the lecture, where we here in this case read a CSV file from a directory. This is actually analogous to what we've covered already in the notebooks. Here we are defining an image folder. So this would be, for example, our mnist.png file folder. We are defining optional data transformations. And here specifically, we save some attributes for convenience. So the image names are the file path column in the data frame, as we have seen in the previous video. And then the labels are this label column, as we have seen in the previous notebook. So we are now defining this getItem method. So that getItem method gets an index here. And the index here refers to a particular training example. Think of the variable I that we usually like to use when we write equations. It's essentially the same thing. It's referring to a single data point. And then here we are defining how we are loading the image corresponding to that index. For that, we are using the imageOpen method, which gets a file path based on the image folder and the image name here from the file path. Then we have an optional transformation. We will talk about this more in a later lecture. So a transformation is essentially a data augmentation, a slight change of the image. But again, this is a future topic. And then we are also obtaining the labels. The labels can be directly obtained from this label column. And we are returning an image label pair here. So the getItem method is returning a single image label pair. So and then we have this length method here, which returns the total length of this data set, which is essentially the number of entries in this label column. So we are using .shape here. Then next, we add a little utility to visualize batches. You don't have to use that. It's similar to what we have done or used before, using the vutils make grid function from Torch Vision. You don't have to use that. You can use that to visualize the data. The key part now is implementing the data loading. So for that, we are using an if name main context here. So this will be then executed as a main process if we run this script from the command line, for example. It's also best practice in Python to define functions that we are using in general above here. And then it's a common practice to use this if context here to define all the code that is supposed to be executed in the script. Because if we do it this way, people can still use this script to import functions if they want to without executing anything here inside. So what we are putting here is all the code that we want to execute. First of all, of course, our favorite watermark package to print the current PyTorch version, and then some optional data augmentation or transformations. So here We are resizing the images, randomly cropping them, and then converting them to tensors. And then here we have normalization. In addition to that, but note that for the test one, we have a center crop instead of a random crop, because for the test data points, we don't want any randomness. So now that we have the data transforms defined, we can actually initialize the data sets and the data loaders. So let's start with a training set. So what we do here is we are creating the training set. So we provide here the new train CSV file that we created in the notebook in the previous video. We provide the image folder and then the data transformation. And this is our data set here. From that data set, then we create this data loader. So the data loader is essentially a wrapper around this data set. So we are taking this training data set as input to the data loader. We define the batch size, define the shuffling, and the number of workers. So the number of workers are the number of parallel processes. The more, usually the better, up to a certain point. So depending on the data set, you may want to use 2, 4, 6 workers or even more. Really, the number of workers is kind of like determined by how long it takes to load your data points. In order to find out what is a good number of workers, you practically have to try out different values and see if it accelerates your training or not. So for example, you can start with 1 worker and then increase it up to a certain number until you don't see any changes in the training speed anymore. So let's now do the same thing for the validation and the test set. So where we have again the same code, except that we have now validation instead of training here and test instead of training here. So we have now defined our validation, training and test sets and the data loaders. So what we can do now is we can now iterate over them to see if they work. So what I like to do is just for one epoch, just doing 1 mini batch, for example, or let's say up to 3 mini batches here, and then just breaking out of the function here and just seeing if the batch index, batch size, and the shape of the features and the labels make sense, if they all look okay. And then optionally, you can also visualize the mini batches here with our optional function. So how I execute code in Visual Studio Code is you can either go to the command line. So if I save this and I can go to the command line and then type Python 4.4, this looks correct, typing the path here and then executing this. So this should execute the code. And as you can see, you have a index here for the batch that looks okay to me. And then you have batch size 32 here that looks okay to me. We have for each mini batch 32 examples and then grayscale images, so 1 color channel, 28 by 28. And then for the labels here, we have 32 labels, which looks all correct to me. What's also important is to double check that the labels are shuffled, and this looks good to me. So we can execute things from the command line using just Python and then the name of the file. However, a more convenient way is just to hit the play button here, run Python file. You just have to make sure you are in the right environment. So here I have my Deep Learning Fundamentals environment activated. So here in Conda, you can actually choose different virtual environments. And here I use my Deep Learning Fundamentals one. And then I can hit play here and it will execute this code directly here in my Visual Studio Code editor. In this video, we learned how we can set up custom dataset classes and dataset loaders for our own custom dataset.